All right, guys, so let's get this started. It's been a long day. It's the final event of our third Scala, by the way, conference. I hope that you enjoyed it. We see still, you know, a lot of you around here. And I think this is the first time in the history of Bay Area that Martin is on the panel here. So we're honored and pleased to have creator of Scala on the panel. And illustrious Luis. So basically, that kind of, you know, I was going to ask everybody basically to introduce themselves and say what was the most interesting, most significant thing they did to Scala, and it's kind of, you know, doesn't make sense because, you know, Martin invented this. So I'll ask a different question. So I'll ask everybody first to introduce yourself, and let's kind of do it in, you know, 1 or 2 minutes, and basically say what is the most fun thing you ever did with Scala. How about that?
Ooh, don't choose me first.
Oh, we're going left to right.
Okay, good. Because I need a second to think about it.
I think you're on the left, right?
No. You're on their left.
So, Bill Venners, Scala test. And I do actually several different things. I do teaching, so I get to see what's hard for people. I really enjoy that. I do consulting. I do publishing, editing, writing. Those kinds of things are also really fun. But I think really the funnest thing is actually coding and doing Scala tests because people use it and I work with them. And so that's it for me.
I'm Julie Pitt, and I'm co-founder of Order of Magnitude Labs. And I'm on a quest to build intelligent behavior, machines that are capable of intelligent behavior. And I would actually say that the thing that I have the most fun with in Scala changes probably week to week. And since my most recent excursion was in Scala.js, that was a heck of a lot of fun. So that was a lot of fun.
I'm Martin. You know me. I think there's lots of fun things I did with Scala, but if I should pick one, then I guess it's probably worksheets, to work on worksheets to develop the concept, because that sort of, I seen that puts it on a new level, the interaction with Scala, and also the ease of use of how many people approach it.
My name's Eric Osheim. I work at meetup.com as a senior software engineer on the data team. I've been involved in Scala open source for, I guess, about 4 or 5 years now. And, you know, again, it's sort of tough. There's a lot of things that are fun. I think probably the thing that has been most fun over the years was sort of the development of the compiler plugin I wrote, Kind Projector, because it started out as this like really ugly hack. I mean, incredibly ugly, right? It transforms untyped trees. It's really horrible. And I never expected that it would actually ever be used in production by anyone, you know? And it just kind of kept going and going, and there were kept being these, I was like, oh, I don't think I can solve this part, and then I figured out a way to do that. And so now at this point now, you know, it's got tons of features and people use it, and it's just been kind of a funny to see the whole thing unfold this way, you know?
And for me, I think Julie's answer was really good because it changes a lot. But the one that popped into my head first was I wrote something called a linkage disequilibrium calculator, which is used in genetics to figure out whether genes are related to one another. And at the time I wrote it, the scientist who tasked me with the job neglected to tell me that these things are always written as kind of batch operations. So I wrote it as a real-time thing. I couldn't get it fast enough. I kept iterating over it and getting it faster and faster. And finally, she comes back and says, how's it running? And I said, I can only do about 4,000 of these a second. And she's like, well, how long does it take to run overnight? And I'm like, no, you just do them right now. And apparently people don't do that. So it was kind of cool that she was as surprised as I was that this thing ran in real time. So that was probably my coolest one.
All right. So here's how this is going to go. So basically, I'll ask one starting question from each panelist, and they will answer it all again in sequence, where we'll go in the other direction for fun. And then we collected a tremendous amount of questions. So when I started this survey several weeks ago and asked Typesafe to basically email everybody, I thought, you know, I really want every Scala user in the world to ask a question. And we got about 60 questions, right? So obviously, like, there are more users in the world. So I wonder, you know, are people, whether they don't have questions or kind of if they can think of a good question. But this is an interesting, you know, thing. I'm going to probably send a survey, why didn't you ask the question in the first place, right? And we'll see what happens. But we got some really good questions, so thanks for sending them here. What we've asked all the panelists to do is to basically look them over and select one question which they like and then answer it, right? So that will be the second question for each of the panelists. And then we'll open it to the audience. So we'll have two mics here. So once every panelist answers two questions, we'll basically open it up. And we have five awesome Typesafe backpacks to give as prizes for the best questions. So while you guys are asking questions, each of us will make some mental notes, and then we'll compute the set intersection of ordered sets, in a sense, if there is such a thing, right? And basically, we'll need to come up with an algorithm on the spot to essentially to assign these bags to the winners.
What could possibly go wrong?
Yes. So here's the plan. So the question which we prepared for each of you guys is, should Scala strive to be a mainstream language like Java? So a lot of folks you remember Rod Johnson basically gave a great keynote in New York, and he said, you guys should be like Java, you should simplify this, right? And so we have a lot of this debate, should we basically err on the side of simplification to gain mind share and market share? Should we maintain intellectual purity and honesty, as kind of Dibblegoy always says, nothing is worth, you should maintain at all costs? I think there is this kind of ultimate tension, and I just want folks to kind of attack it heads on. And so I'd like everybody to kind of tell truthfully and honestly, what do you really think? Should we go for the world domination at the expense of dumbing things down, or should we not? Does it make sense?
Me
good
too.
Luck, Dick.
Oh,
you got
God.
This.
All right. Well, I've done a lot of thinking about this answer. I think actually Java, first of all, I should say, I worked in it for 15 years. I am where I am now because of Java. You cannot say really bad things about Java. That said, I think Java's a very interesting experiment that shows what happens when a language becomes completely dominant and then largely stagnates for 10 years. And the effect that it had on programming in that time was essentially to freeze a lot of the progress that we could have made. So I don't think that the question is necessarily right, in my opinion. I don't think Scala should be shooting for that. I don't think any language should shoot for that. Again, it's not healthy to have a language that's that dominant, in my opinion, for that length of time.
Yeah, so I mean, I guess I wouldn't disagree with Dick. The way I would sort of think about it is like there's sort of a positive and a negative way to frame what mainstream means. Like in one sense, you could sort of say, well, should Scala be as easy to use as, Python or something? And I would say, well, yes, it should. Or should it be as, fast as something else? And well, yes. I mean, I would say it should be mainstream in terms of approachability, in terms of, being a nice language to use, all these things. But there's a sense of like, oh, well, we should stop doing these experiments. We should stop playing around and get serious, and everyone should put their, enterprise suspenders on or something. And like, I absolutely disagree with that. Like, I was never a Java programmer. I don't see a vibrant Scala path for Scala where it says, well, we shouldn't do this interesting stuff. We need to sort of settle on this one thing and have it just be done. So that's kind of my take.
Yeah, I largely agree with both Dick and Eric. I think what we're seeing is a gradual shift towards functional programming, and I think that's mostly for the good, and Scala is leading that to a certain degree. And I think what we should strive for is to have essentially organic growth over the next few years. So it would be terrible if we became a mainstream language of the size of, let's say, Java or C Sharp or the several others tomorrow, because that would mean that basically we couldn't innovate anymore and we couldn't change things anymore and we couldn't experiment. At the same time, I think we are in a certain responsibility to actually lead the charge of functional programming in the industry, and we shouldn't shy away from that either. So it's a difficult middle that we have to find here to say, well, yes, we want to sort of grow steadily and slowly. We definitely want to have a sustainable ecosystem. We have that already, but I mean, the more people come in, the more energy is there to get the right libraries, the right tools to make progress, and all this is very good. At the same time, we should really be careful not to essentially standardize too soon, not to become stale too soon. So
I guess my response to this would be, you know, why do we have to choose? And we have to look at, you know, who the audience is, right? There was kind of a big theme at Scala Days where talking about, well, Scala has kind of gone from early adopter to perhaps early mainstream. And I would say probably the folks in this room are closer to the early adopter phase. And so my take is I don't think it would actually be a bad outcome if Scala ultimately became mainstream. And there might be a point at which, yes, it has to adapt slowly because of that, but at the same time, the innovators are still going to be there, and they still will say, okay, well, now what's the next thing? How can we build the next generation on top of that? So, you know, if you look at, if Scala became mainstream and functional programming was really mainstream, hey, that's a huge step above, you know, where we were at 10, 15 years ago with Java, right? So I think it's just a constant evolution, and we shouldn't be afraid to go, well, if it is going too slow, we'll probably end up figuring out the next paradigm and the next language.
And what I would just add to that, I guess, is that I think there are ways to innovate and make things better while still trying to minimize user pain, that broken code, and we should try to do that because there's a lot of people who have invested in code already. The benefit that Java provided to the industry is it really was stable, and it just, you put a method, if a method got in 1.0, it never got removed. It might be deprecated, but it's still there, even though it's terrible. And so that did minimize a cost of like upgrading to the new version of Java, but there's something Bruce Eckel once told me, which I thought was important, in that if you don't ever fix any of those things, then this stuff accretes, and there's a cost of complexity that happens. So you have to actually, it's actually better for people if you do fix some of those things, I think, over time. So that's what we have to, I think that's what we should do, is keep innovating, but also really care about, you know, preserving people's investment to a great extent.
Yeah. If you look at Python has done that, and they've cleaned things up as they've gone, they've taken it out. I've always said if Scala can maintain a market share like Python has for as many years as Python, that's a massive success. That's where, you know, that's kind of where we want to be with that, that mix of improvement and market share and acceptability.
By the way, feel free to, you know, respond to responses and have a conversation, right? Like, we're pretty flexible and formal here. So now for the part where you guys pick a question you like and answer it. So let's start with Dick.
Again? Oh. Well, I'm going to take the community one, of course. And I'm not going to limit myself to one answer because I'm a rebel. So the question is, what is one missing open source Scala community initiative, or one initiative that deserves more attention or support? The easy answer is Scala libraries have probably been the most overlooked and underloved things for a long time, the core libraries in Scala, and we're trying to fix that right now. The bigger question is, there isn't one, there's loads. Fortunately, there's loads of developers, and all of you guys should pick something and just go get cranking on it. See what you can do. Many hands make light work and all of that. I think just concentrating on one is probably dangerous. If it's going to be one, the core libraries are something to take a look at and see if you can improve. But whatever it is, whatever you want to end up doing, cats is a great example of finding something and just going for it. Howie Lee, with Scala.js. That came out of nowhere. I thought Scala.js was dead, and you know, Sebastian and Lee Howie and others just sort of picked it up and started running with it again. This is what we need. This, just pick something and work on it.
So let me actually check, because sure, I want to credit who asked the question.
Who asked mine?
I don't know. I should do that.
Super quick. Mine was from Tihomerb?
Yeah. All right.
Okay.
All right. So, I really should have written this down. I'll try and see who asked this question. But there was a really interesting question that someone asked, which was,
I'll look for it while you talk.
can Scala be more expressive than natural language, do you think? And I thought that was a really great question to ask because, of course, natural language is very flexible and very expressive, and there's so many different sort of idioms and modes of speech. I mean, anyone who's studied any of the linguistics knows that, like, there's all these really interesting sort of theories of meaning at different moments in a conversation. But I do think the answer is yes, actually, that Scala can easily be more expressive than, you know, natural language. You know, whatever your native language is, I think Scala can be more. In the sense that I think with Scala, we can kind of encode sort of these precise mathematical definitions. So I think a great example of this is something that I think Stu talked about in the last talk, which is the idea of trying to come up with laws for your code that should apply no matter what, invariants. And then, you know, in some sense, we can write a bunch of documentation, and we need to. I mean, for the CAST project, we want to write this documentation. But if you can just go to the code and say, well, they say that for all A, this will be true no matter what. I think that's a really powerful thing. We can say that it's very clear. There's no ambiguity there. The Scala, you know, runtime or the Java runtime and Scala compiler is going to treat this one way. And if you are, you know, literate in Scala, you can immediately know what we mean. Whereas if we're using, you know, a paragraph or two of terms, you might not be familiar with. There might be some ambiguity in how you read it. So I do think the answer is yes, both in terms of this kind of law checking, and I also think some of the fluent DSLs we've seen, like I think like the Axel DSL, for example, the way that it maybe illustrates a paradox of probability. You know, I think trying to explain the Monty Hall problem might be a lot harder than just sort of producing a DSL and saying, well, here's how it actually runs, and here's the answer that proves you should switch rather than stay. So I think it's a great question to be thinking about. I think it's a really important idea, and I would say the answer is yes. The question was asked by
Katrine.
So yeah, great question.
I have a problem here because the question that I find best, I don't have an answer for.
We want to still ask it.
Yeah. Okay, I tell the question and throw it back. So the question was, there's a broad and deep body in object-oriented analysis and design methodologies with corresponding notation UML, well, maybe not so much UML, but the analysis. Why hasn't an equivalent arisen in functional programming? Is it a matter of maturity, or is there something fundamentally different about analysis and design in functional programming that does not require an equivalent? And the answer is, I don't really know, but I would really like to know the answer of that question. So what is functional analysis and design, and would it necessarily be the same? I just had a talk at the JVM Languages Symposium about the new compiler, and there I actually used a lot of entity relationship diagrams and stuff like that. And I just wonder, is that something that can be generalized or not? Again, I don't know. So my vote goes for that question. But a question I can answer would be something much more concrete. How can we best prepare for a shift towards study? What can we be studying? What constructs in our Scala code should we avoid to reduce the cost of migrating? And what's the current best guess when we might be able to start generating code? So I guess since I'm sort of the person in the middle of that, I can't give you a complete answer, but I will try my best. So Dotty is currently very close to bootstrap, which means the compiler can compile itself. So compiler is written in sort of the intersection of Scala and Dotty, which is fortunately very, very large. So basically, it's all of Scala except for the experimental parts. I believe my best guess for something that you can actually use out there is maybe at this time next year, something like that. So it doesn't probably go much faster than that. What can you do to prepare? What should you avoid there? I think we have a SIP language imports. So essentially, everything that requires a language import is dubious, in particular experimental types, structural types, this sort of thing. Higher kind of types, that was actually another question that's related to that. We've been working on that a lot to make it possible. And essentially, the way we will do that is using kind projector as a feature in the language. So essentially, there will be type lambdas. Anything that fits in a type lambda would work. So far, I've seen a single thing, a concrete thing that doesn't work. And that is if you write, let's say you write a higher kind of type monad, and then you want to write monad of underscore, which means monad of a type I don't know. So that's sort of an existential in a higher kind. And I don't know how to express that, sorry. So that will probably not work. And the other thing I can't put my hand in the fire is, will type inference for higher kind of types work in exactly the same way? Again, I don't know. So these are things that we probably have to wait to get the answer. Okay.
So the question I chose came from Roberto Burgos, and he asks, languages like Ruby, JavaScript, Python, and their respective frameworks and libraries, and to an extent, Android and iOS development, have played a crucial role in teaching various underprivileged groups how to code and exposing them to programming and engineering. I often wonder why there aren't programs like these teaching Scala and the Typesafe platform as popular as it is rapidly becoming. Does Typesafe have an interest in promoting their platform to target these groups beyond the Coursera courses? And if so, how would you go about it? So I actually want to turn this question around and replace the word Typesafe with the word community. First of all, I don't think that this is really something that one particular entity should fully address or could fully address. I think it's actually up to the community at large. And I'll share with you an experience I had at Scala Days. I was coming out of this session learning some fancy error handling pattern, and I was really pumped up and really excited about it. Like, yeah, you know, I want to use that. But I turned to my fellow attendee and said, hey, you know, what did you think of the session? And she said, you know, I'm pretty disappointed because there's a lot of these like speculative things, being discussed here, but there's not a lot of things that are I can just take home and start using today, right? And I believe that all of this, the kernels are there, and we just need to sort of keep in mind that the beginner mindset is very different from where we're at now, and we have to remember what was it like when we first encountered Scala and try to make it easy for those coming in. And I think one tool in particular coming out is Scala.js now allows us to run Scala code and compile it to JS in the browser. And there's a great tool that called Scala.js Fiddle. So if you know what JS Fiddle is, you know what that is. And that's a zero setup. You can literally load a web page and start typing Scala code, and you can hit a key command and see that change in the browser. So I've worked with kids in getting them involved in coding, and what I've observed is when the setup is extremely easy, it's no-brainer. So I think we need to make it easy for folks to come in and really not lose that beginner mindset.
There's also Kojo, which is essentially used in I think some Indian school for a particular for essentially disadvantaged girls coming from disadvantaged Indian families that essentially learn programming with Kojo. I think that's also very inspiring, and yeah, you completely agree. We want to see more of that. That would be great.
Yeah, I would echo it. I mean, I think that one of the interesting root causes, and I think Scala's success partially involves bootstrapping off of an existing Java user base, people who are familiar with Java development, who are maybe professional Java developers. But I think an interesting and maybe negative side effect of that has been that, unlike other languages who assumed that they were mostly finding new programmers and saying, well, these are people who've never written an if statement or have no one to know about control flow, Scala has largely been able to assume that it's new users were familiar with these concepts. And I think there's certainly a dearth of materials for, let's teach you about programming in general, from the ground up, basically.
Actually, that reminds me, quick plug. So there's a book called Atomic Scala, written by Bruce Eckel and Diane Marsh. And that book is kind of this very gentle introduction. It doesn't assume you know Java. It doesn't assume you know programming. So what if we can get something like that and get that as a sort of web-based course? I think that would really bring that visibility and that accessibility.
Bill, you have a question?
Well, before I go to my question, I'll add one thing. So my niece is 14. She came visit me 2 weeks ago, and she brought her friend, who's also 14. I've actually had 7 guests come through in the last 2 months, so that was 2 of them. And then a friend of mine came, and he also has a daughter who's 14. Everybody was 14. So I thought, well, we did a lot of fun things, but one educational thing we did I thought would be cool to try is we went over to Dave Brichetti's house. He teaches programming to kids, and I thought, let's see if we can get them to use Scala. And because, one of them is science-minded, and, I just thought it would be interesting. And so we started out using something that was Java code, and one thing, the person I was watching, they did something I'd never seen before, is so she was supposed to copy the code down and get it to work. She copied it from the bottom up, so she wrote Java code backwards. So that was pretty cool. And then we switched to Scala, and there was one step of setup he didn't tell us about. And it was like when Dick and I, in the early days especially, would like spend a half an hour trying to get setup to work, and we lost him in 3 minutes. And so we switched to something that wasn't Scala. So I think that what you said about really simple setup and it works is very important for beginners, because you don't have much time before they think, well, this is too hard.
Out-of-box experience really matters, yeah.
We're using IntelliJ, and it's got all these things, right? So that's what my point I wanted to make, is that I do agree that's important. The question I picked is by Bill Bourne. It says, is it time to introduce some form of community specification process for the broader Scala ecosystem? I'm hearing increasing complaints about the lack of stability in APIs and challenges in building larger applications as libraries and frameworks change without warning. No. Because I would hate, I mean, it's hard enough to get people to like work and give away open source software for free. To make them go through some kind of process would be, it would just shut them down. But that said, that I heard that. I mean, that's a complaint that I imagine is a pain people are feeling. And the other thing I wanted to say is that what I've found is because Scala Test is free, people tend to not want to complain about it, even when they have pain, so I don't hear about it. Like, for example, I had dinner with this guy last night, and he says, oh, by the way, this one thing it's like caused me a lot of pain. I was like, well, you know, he just fixed it on his end instead of getting, and it wasn't just him, it was the other guy we were having dinner with, Mike Bilquist, also had experienced that pain, but that was the first I heard about it. And I'm the same way. I mean, I just work around the problem, but I don't have time to email the person. But so I think part of that is just, you know, we need to hear about it. Like I heard about it just now that, you know, people may be having this pain of like dependencies and stuff. And part of it is binary compatibility, but I think most of it, it's not just that, it's that we break things. And you know, as we become more successful or more adopted, we need to be more careful about, you know, migrating people.
Can I ask about that? Did the change that you make, was it in a branch of yours on GitHub?
It's in a milestone release, and the reason everybody who's using it because it supports Scala.js.
Okay.
So it's not a finished one, and I will fix it before it's finished, but that doesn't mean it caused pain to people.
I just wondered, I think one of the things right now is that I fix things, and I always put in a pull request, even if I don't have a lot of confidence that the project is even active anymore. For the reason that you said, maybe it is active, maybe the guy will see it, or whoever it is will see it, and bring that in. Even if they don't like the change, it at least starts the conversation or lets them know there was something that didn't work. So I do think that there's maybe a lesson there of making a pull request doesn't mean it's going to get in, but it also doesn't mean that you shouldn't make that pull request. You know, it starts the conversation or something, and it's pretty low commitment, pretty low hassle.
On the topic of frameworks, you know, using Spring years ago kind of gave me PTSD. So I'm not big on frameworks myself, but I do think that there's a place for them. And I think this goes back to the question of where are we on this adoption curve? Are we going mainstream or not? And I think if you have many examples of a problem that are extremely similar and they all fit in the same criteria, that frameworks are great way to apply that, right? I don't want to be hamstrung and not be allowed to solve novel problems. So I think we do need to consider frameworks, but also not lose that spontaneity and the vibrancy of the community in the process.
So guys, if you have questions, please line up. We have two mics in the aisles, I believe. Let's see, both, yeah, so please come up, don't be shy. And while you're doing this, I'll ask one follow-up question for Martin, which actually is from Miles Sabin, which I thought is a bit facetious, but now that I heard about Dati, I think it's not so facetious anymore. So he is asking, when will Spark run on Dati?
You should ask the Spark people. Not
when somebody ports it.
Right.
So folks in the audience, I think this is, you know, a great opportunity to ask Martin and all the great panelists. So if you have questions, please come up. And please introduce yourself.
I'm Stuart. I'm still trying to find a reason to learn Scala. It's so big that I need to find separable pieces. A long time ago, in another universe, I learned APL, and APL was separable. So I didn't have to know everything about everything in APL to get something working, particularly in ocean simulation. But I got into it slowly but surely. And I don't see that in, well, maybe in the talks, but maybe Bruce Eccles' book will help me there. That's so separability in the layers of Scala. I mean, I know I'm going to get bitten by something that I haven't read, like implicits or something, but should try to minimize that, at least in teaching it.
Yeah, sure, but if you, I think we actually did a lot of effort to do precisely that, and I would say Scala is an extremely separable language. We have a lot of people who are completely non-experts and who are fluent in Scala much, much faster than in Java. So what I would say is take any IDE or a web-based one, pull out a worksheet and start playing with collections. You get your old APL feeling back without the symbols, so with like a nice intelligible names, and it's just the same power. And that's like how a lot of people find to Scala. And now you don't need to know about implicits or any of that thing. So I think there's a certain danger, and because we're here in an expert circle, that we talk about essentially the mechanics that make it work. And Scala is a language that is, where it's very hard to make that clear, because Scala is, from its design, a library-based language. That means that in the core language, there are very few primitives. So essentially, the language doesn't give you a lot of primitives to do things. It doesn't even have a built-in notion of a collection. There's really nothing. It doesn't have collection literals. It has not a single thing. So everything is built then with a library layer. Now, if you concentrate on how these libraries are built, then I'm not surprised you would be confused, because there's a lot of really high tech in there, complicated technologies to make a very, very easy user interface. So I think you should just ignore all that and look at it from the standpoint of a user who just wants to get this stuff done. And then I would say it's actually not more complicated. I would actually argue it's a lot simpler than most of the alternatives.
When I started, I expect, like everyone who starts Scala, I wrote, because I would come from Java, I wrote, my first thing was writing Java in Scala. And if I went back and look at it now, it would be horrible to look at. But the point is, you've got to make that first step. And the first step is going to suck. So what I will say to you in front of all these people as witnesses is, I give you permission to write some really, really crappy Scala code. Go forth, do it, and if anybody gives you any crap, send them to me, and I'll explain why I told you you can do it.
I'm not going to post it on GitHub.
right.
Nobody's going to look at it.
Yeah, you just got to start somewhere. So
I just want to add to that as well. Coming, like many of you, coming from the Java world, what was my motivating factor? I think it was actually having read Effective Java by Josh Block. We probably, most of you know about that book. You know, he talked about, here's all of these patterns that you want to follow in the Java language. And it was great because it gave kind of this principled approach. But on the other hand, I'm like, why do I need 50 lines of code to make this class immutable, right? Why do I need to follow, you know, go to the trouble of overwriting equals and hash code and all these crazy things? And so that was kind of the hook, that plus, you know, wanting to use closures. But I think also what really drew me in was the consistency of it. You know, you don't have to deal with primitives separately from objects. You know, everything's a function call. There's not these operators separately. So those are some of the hooks that got me really excited about Scala initially.
Can I add something about that comment real quick? If you look at some of the signatures in the collections library, that's also going to scare people. And one of the things Martin said, I don't know when, maybe a year or two, or 2 years ago probably, I don't know where, you said what you want to focus on is making Scala simpler. And that's what the whole Dottie thing is. You can take six pieces of the type system and express three of them in terms of the other three, and then now you only have three pieces, actually. I think that was unusual. It was very rare to hear that kind of thing. And
the one thing that riles me up a little bit is, so there might very well be in the future a redesign of the collections that doesn't have Ken Bildfram and all this stuff. And you will use it exactly like you use it before. Not a single character will change in your program. So this is all people really drilling down into implementation details they shouldn't be worried about. But because a lot of blog posts would like to essentially show this, either to show, well, it's really complex, or look how smart I am, a lot of people do that. And that's really, and I think if there is one thing that I have come to realize in the design of Scala, which was problematic maybe, is that this line of where it is simple and where it becomes complex and what is still possible is a little bit fuzzy. So other languages, some stuff is simple, other stuff is impossible. So and or just ridiculously complicated that nobody would even try that. Scala has a sort of very soft boundary by design, which excites a lot of people because they can do stuff that they can't do in other languages. But for a lot of users that can newcomers, that can be frightening. So that's a thing where I'm not yet sure whether one can do something about it. And what a better design would be, but that's sort of where a lot of this sort of complexity argument comes from. It's a soft boundary between what is still possible and what is sort of where it becomes really complicated. You have a lot of tools at your disposal to push the boundary, but then it becomes ugly also.
So before you ask the next question, I just want to let the panelists know we have glasses of water next to your chairs behind.
Oh.
So in case you need more, we'll bring in more.
No.
Right? So
no,
we kind of did an asynchronous process, which brought this watering. Other questions?
So on the topic of Miles Sabin, he's got a bunch of Stack Overflow answers, which are like, you know, can you implement type minus in Scala? So I want this function to take things that are a subclass of A but not a subclass of B. And he's like, yes, using this crazy implicit stuff. And it eventually works, but it's ugly, and you have to like write it yourself. And the errors given by the compiler when you don't go along with this are very ugly. And he says, so the compiler has the ability to detect this. We just don't have an elegant. It just chooses not to tell us. The compiler writers have just chosen not to implement these features in a nice way as of yet. So do we have any hope of in the future Scala compiler like being nicer to us when we want to have type minus or anonymous type unions or complex fun things like that?
Yeah. I think we will definitely, in due time, we'll get a lot of that in the language. I'm pretty sure. Yeah.
Fantastic.
Yeah. Hi, I'm Adam. So one question for you. There's kind of two styles of Scala. So you have the experienced Java programmer who's been doing it for 6 years, speaking personal experience, who wants to transition to Scala. And I see a lot, but idiomatic Scala, especially like functional style, can be harder, you know, that's kind of a harder transition for a lot of people. So, you know, you typically, like how I've seen Scala done is people will learn JVM tooling and then they'll learn then they'll kind of start learning idiomatic Scala as they go. So they use Java as an onboarding process and then they transition. How would you recommend to make that transition smoothest? And when do you write sort of object-oriented Scala versus functional Scala?
For me, there's no difference. So again, I think that's a mischaracterization. So when you say Java-like style, people who just use map and filter and stuff like that on collections, is that Java-like style or is that functional style?
I'm just thinking in general, like, oh, I have wrap everything in a class, mutable state, like a lot of things that are probably not considered good practice in Scala.
But a lot of people don't wrap things in mutable state. They use classes and they use things like map and filter and fold. But they don't use monads and they don't use applicatives. Is that functional or is it Java?
I'd say okay. So when you start getting into monads and that kind of stuff, people just don't think like that in
okay.
Java. Like things are the language mechanics are simpler. Yeah. So like how do you onboard into like monads and some of these other like more complex functional concepts?
Well, for me, the important thing is. So I think it's a mischaracterization to say they write like Java. They don't. So I think maybe they write things like what people in Java are just new to in Java 8, collections in Java 8. But I think the core of Scala would be something predominantly functional, almost exclusively functional, writing stuff with typically collection operations, putting stuff in classes, using classes as a structuring mechanism. Scala was designed to prove the point that object-oriented and functional programming is not incompatible. So the thing that upsets me most is that people in the Scala Scala community say, look, there's functional and there's Java, and the two can't get together. Scala was designed to disprove what those people say.
To be fair, that's what drew me to the language. I was just curious what your thoughts on there. Yeah.
Thank you for the provocative question.
So I will, at the risk of drawing down the ire of Jove, I will actually try and answer your question in a different way, which is, from my point of view, I actually was talking to Michael Pilquist yesterday about this, and I 100% agree with his stance, which is, I don't think people should learn monads for their own sake at all. I really just don't. And that's certainly, I didn't come to Scala knowing anything about that stuff. I really appreciate sort of his view that it's a bottom-up process. In other words, you have a particular domain, and you basically are making iterative improvements. So first you do it in a very concrete way. I wouldn't say Java way, I would just say a concrete way, where it's very specific to your domain, and then you start thinking of how can I generalize, how can I remove code reuse, how can I make this more provably correct? And you probably will find your way to those concepts in one way or another, like the way he talked about sort of the lax monoidal functors that he kind of essentially discovered for himself, but they already existed, but he had, that's the way I think people would find their way to these things. And I think that's the most effective too, because you have a specific case and you know why it's useful. Like in my case, I wanted to abstract over mathematical operations. I knew why I needed to do that. No one had to prove to me that a field or a group or a ring was useful because I specifically knew why I needed them.
I think you gave me a nice setup for what I was actually going to say right before that, and it feeds so nicely into this, which is exactly that. And in fact, Java 8 has done some of this work for us now. The new Streams API, or Stream API, Java 8 Streams, and the completable future, if you dig into those, which I did recently, Streams is monadic, has flat map and map and so on over it, and that's the new hotness. People are learning that because it's the cool thing in Java. Completable future has flat map on it. It's not that name, but the type signature is there. The type contract is there. I forget what it is offhand. It's like compose and then or something it's called. But
does it pass the laws?
I can tell you without looking at it. But it's there in spirit. The idea is that you compose them together like this. And so that will help that transition as well. This is now the accepted way to do streaming operations and file operations in Java. So that's going to feed into more people. I've always said it, Java 8 is probably the best thing that's happened to Scala in a while. It's going to get a lot of people thinking in those terms, and then they're going to look around and see what else they can get out of a language which does slightly more. So,
I would actually add that I think it's okay to program in different styles. The different parts of the community are attracted to different styles. That for different kinds of tasks, people think a different style is appropriate. And so I write code that I consider functional. It doesn't use Scala Z. I don't have a monad type class. I'm using for expressions. Maybe it probably passes the monad laws, but I don't really think about that, and that's okay, I think. But the folks that I know that really like sort of the Scala Z or Cat's way, that's great. They get a lot of value out of it. And then if you're coming from Java and you just want to get going, that's a good reason to write it that way. And the other time I actually wrote a lot of while loops in Scala this past week because I need to make something fast with arrays. And that's what's great about Scala is you can do that.
Yeah.
And I made an immutable object that on the inside. It's very, very imperative for speed. And that's okay too. So I think that it is like people coming from Java should become more functional and that's going to make them a better programmer, but they don't have to go all the way to Scala Z, or if they can't, if they want to, they can.
Hi, my name is Eric Innocent, and I'd like to just take a second to thank Martin for your work with the Coursera courses, which are what introduced me to Scala. So.
Yay. Yay.
It's sort of strange hearing your voice not sped up by 50%. So my question is, actually, Julie brought this to mind when you mentioned Josh Block's Effective Scala earlier, or Effective Java. I was wondering, is there a resource that you guys have in mind that is sort of like the Scala equivalent of, I guess, best practices that, like the equivalent of Effective Java? I know there's an Effective Scala document that Twitter has put out. There's also the Scala cookbook by Alvin, whatever his name is, which I've also been reading. But I was wondering if you guys have any suggestions or if you think there should be one.
I've been giving this a lot of thought, and it's, oh, wow, that was really weird. It's something that I'd love to see happen. It's on my to-do list as soon as the slip-sip stuff is sort of under some level of forward motion that's going to keep going without pushing on it the whole time. But I'd like to see us start making a cookbook or something like that in Scala Lang, where we can gather and discuss these ideas. It's not a slam dunk. Good ideas change. We know, Bill and I, from doing our course, that best practices change month to month, week to week. Something that was considered good practice is suddenly not anymore. So this thing needs to be some kind of living thing, but it would be really good to have that. I've heard it many times, particularly since picking up more of the community side, that this is a resource people would like to see, and it's going to have to be something that a lot of people put work into, because there's too much there for one person to do, I think.
You're going to vote which is the best practice and which is not. Are we going to crowdsource it and vote?
Yeah, something like that. It's got to be something like that, hasn't it?
Well, so I sort of agree with Alexi's objection. I don't think there's ever going to be one thing that's just the way everyone's supposed to do it. But I do think that the thing we've accumulated over the last many years in the community is a lot of lore about, like, if you want this, this is the right way to encode it. If you want this, this is the right way to do it. You know, and you may not want it, which is okay. So I think we do need something which just says, if you want to have a sealed ADT, here's the way that you encode it that helps type inference work properly. Or if you want to do type class encoding, here's kind of the way we've come up with that we think works the best or something. And it doesn't have to be, everyone should be always doing it this way, but, here's the way that people have found that it works.
Yeah.
And we can kind of learn to kind of recognize these patterns and sort of reinforce them, basically.
One I always say is loans are very easy to use, and they're usually nice. If you ever allow a generic in a loan, people return the thing that you're loaning to the outside of it, which is usually an iterator or something like that, and then try and use it. That's a common piece of knowledge which needs to be shared. It's the sort of thing that will happen, and you just need to know about that kind of thing. So, yeah, that's a whole cookbook is what I would suggest. Like, let's start gathering recipes and putting them out there.
So, quick poll: how many of you guys have some document inside your company that talks about coding standards in Scala?
Hmm. Yeah.
Okay, that's a lot of hands. And I mean, when it comes to creating something like this, it seems like that knowledge is already out there, and it's really, we just need to create it and get it out there. And I think you guys probably already have a lot of great recipes.
Hello, guys. My name is Andrew Kuhnhausen. I met some of you throughout the day, and thank you to all of you for the work that you've been doing in the Scala community. And creating it as well.
just that small aside, by the way.
So my question is mostly from, like, to defud my head. Because I'm coming into this, totally FUD it up. To verbify FUD. So I know that 2.11 was talking about sort of stability of API and, like, compatibility, and then Tasty got adopted by Dottie for binary compatibility reasons. I'm hearing a lot of people at my work saying, like, oh, we don't, like, I'm really worried about using Scala because of binary incompatibility between library versions, and sort of what is the direction of Tasty in terms of adoption into Scala C, and maybe backporting into older versions, if that's even a possibility, and sort of what's the direction moving forward for Scala and binary compatibility? Thank you.
Yeah, so I'm betting on essentially Tasty is our best bet there, I think. So what's currently happening, Tasty is now the standard interchange format in the Dottie compiler. And there's somebody, his name is Vladimir Nikolaev, he's working on backporting that into Scala C using Scala Meta as sort of the framework. That work is still ongoing. So I keep my fingers crossed that something good will come out. And once we have that, that will be a prototype. We have to sort of stabilize that and then at some point, hopefully, get that back into the Scala C compiler and make that essentially then a essentially alternative backend. I believe that it will probably work that for a while there will be the choice of the new experimental tasty backend and the old one. And then once we have that, then hopefully we can essentially attack the binary compatibility problem. But it will be it will take some time. It's just that there is light at the end of the tunnel. I really hope there is.
Reed Spencer with Reactific. Thanks for this panel. It's great of you to do this. I asked a question on LinkedIn close to a year ago, maybe end of last year, about whether a Scala VM would be a good idea. In other words, sort of separate the language from its JVM underpinnings, keep compatibility. And I was actually surprised. I got hundreds and hundreds of responses back to that question. And I thought I'd just pose the question here to this panel. Whether that's a good idea. Mostly the responses came back in two forms. One was the freedom of being able to go off and do our own thing with a separate VM versus, no, we need the Java community and we need the JVM and all that it brings. And I'm just wondering what the panel thinks about that.
I mean, I don't have any special pull in this issue, but I feel like Scala.js is already sort of an existence proof that we can do it, right? So I mean, the argument that it has to be JVM only is already bogus. I mean, we've disproved that already. But I would say, from what I can tell, the issue is that it's just a Herculean amount of work to support a runtime, right? And so the Scala.js folks have spent a Herculean amount of time, and it's really good. I know Simon Oxenreiter was working on getting Avian working with Scala, which is a very different JVM implementation. I think anyone who wants something could possibly collaborate there. I know there was work around LLVM, but it was just too much for one person. So I think the answer is yes, we can definitely do it, but there has to be a serious amount of energy. It can't just be people asking for it. I mean, I think that's what I hear a lot of people saying, well, I wish there was a runtime. Well, it's like, well, we all wish there was lots of stuff, So I mean, you kind of have to, you sort of have to, try and make it happen, one way or another.
Or wish harder. You could try wishing
harder. Find a lamp.
Yeah.
I guess while we're talking about, Scala on non-JVM, I think the moment that we arrive will be when we can, Scala.js as the proof of concept, when we can convince JavaScript developers to write their applications in Scala. So that's actually personally what I would want to see out of this is, I came at it, from a Java developer, and then I was convinced to use Scala because of the, I knew the runtime and the ecosystem was there. So now we're talking about going into the JavaScript world with a whole ecosystem there that we can leverage. And so if the JavaScript developers start coming into Scala, that's actually a really good sign. So I'm hoping to see a lot more community effort getting plugged into the JavaScript community, and then we can start branching out into other runtimes.
Yeah, I think you are walking away from quite a lot. If you just up and left the JVM, you have to consider what you're walking away from, which is 20 years of, apart from anything else, insane optimizations that no one in their right mind would sit down and code for a new VM. Not in any reasonable period of time. There's a ton of work that's gone in there. It has a lot of ratty, cobwebby corners and things, but underneath, hotspot's still pretty good. You'd be leaving a lot there. But like you say, it's already on other platforms. I think for server-side stuff, the JVM's still a pretty good one.
I was wondering if any...
I just wanted to see Alexi when I'm asking this question. It's not like I'm asking you, but in general. So many, many years ago, there was assembly. And then came C and killed it. And then it was like a king. And then came C++ and sort of killed C. And then there was Java. So what is it in Scala that for it, someone younger will kill it? Or it's inevitably is going to be king forever?
I still know who's someone who writes all their code in assembly. So there's at least one person out there. And C never died. I don't think it's necessary that a language
maybe we wish
dies.
It had died.
Go's trying to kill it, but I saw a good tweet the other day. Many languages are fighting the last war, but Go is fighting the war of 1812.
That was
I'm sorry. I'm not anti-Go, but that one did make me laugh.
Yeah.
Someone tweeted immediately.
But I don't think that. I think there's room for.
I don't know what it is, but I expect something to.
Yeah.
Eat its lunch. And I didn't really. I mean, I figured something would come along after Java, but I really didn't see what it was until it hit, and I was like, I like that. But
maybe.
Something will.
Maybe it'll be actually, the first quantum programming language.
Yeah, but
that kills
we actually asked Martin one time appeared at one of our very early courses. Dick and I did. We had him come as a cameo. And when he showed up on the screen, it was just this dark figure, like someone who doesn't want to be known what his identity is. And we asked you, like, what are people going to be saying about Scala in 10 years? And he's going to say, well, they're all going to be complaining about it, which was a joke at the time, but now everybody is complaining about it. And we all laughed. It's like, oh, this is so verbose, right? But you hear all these complaints, and I think it's because people are using it. And so they actually encounter things they wish were different or something. But it's a sign of its success. But anyway, I do think it's something will come along.
Hi, I'm Vlad, and I guess many would agree that we have this interesting dark corner in Scala world, which is SBT. So can you shed some light into that dark corner, and like, is there any future?
I can take a quick stab.
Yeah.
I am Mr. I hate all build tools. I really am. Build tools, in my opinion, are just a detail of my job that I really don't care about, and they take far too much of my attention away from what I really care about, which is writing the thing. Having said that, the advances in SBT have made it almost bearable, in my opinion. The fact that you don't have to use the crazy fishbone operator anymore and some of the other stuff in there, I get on okay with it these days. I'm not about to, declare undying love for any build tool, but I don't hate it so bad.
I can
days,
do simple
so.
Things in it now.
Sorry?
I can do simple things in it now, and before I just felt like...
I can actually write custom tasks and do many
oh,
of the
wow.
things that
well,
I
see,
want.
This is the thing, is I... The guy who can do that ends up being the SBT guy in the project, so I try not to get
true,
that good
yes.
at SBT.
So as
but,
long as I can just copy and paste, then I'm okay with SBT. That's fine. Yeah.
And I want to say that, you know, people complained about it, and I even talked to Mark Hara one time. I was like, does that bother you? He says, no. But they complained about certain things, but then everybody used it because they love certain things. One thing that's great about it, just to be positive, is the, say, console, and I have everything on the path. That's fantastic. I get a REPL with everything on the path or the test path. And the other thing that's great about it, that's which is the real reason I think people started using it, was was figuring out what to recompile.
Yeah.
And now you can get that with Maven, with Zinc. But,
I like
that's great. Those are great things about SBT.
I like the continuous iterative
the tilde,
stuff
man.
As well. That's great.
Yeah.
There are
if you know
really
what the tilde is.
About it.
Yeah, I mean, so...
One.
I was never a Java programmer before I came to Scala, so I have no even instinctual understanding of Maven or Ant or any of it. So, I mean, my experience was contrasting it with, like, Make or something like that. And, I mean, I used to find SBT really hard to use, and I feel like there's been a ton of work in the last year or two, and suddenly I find myself just able to do it, kind of. And like kind of like what Julie said, nowadays the build file is a lot easier to get right. There isn't this white space formatting issue. Like, it's not so incomprehensible. So, like, I can just read someone's thing, copy a few lines over, and it just kind of seems to work for me. And now I'm using SBT plugins, and it's a wild and crazy world. So I don't know. I mean, I'm sure there are still problems, but I think the sort of, oh, SBT is bad joke, I think that's a tired joke. You know, I don't think that's an interesting statement to make anymore about it. You know, like, SBT can be hard, but actually I think people have spent a Herculean amount of time making it better. So I'm mostly... like neutral slash positive on it these days.
I've never heard as many people complain as loudly about SBT as I've heard people complain loudly about Maven, so it's all relative.
Maven, where we are back at usages, yeah. But I largely echo Eric that I think it's been through a lot of rough years, but lately it's been shaping up and it's becoming barely usable. Yeah.
By the way, the canned version, the thing I say to people when they're learning this is you don't have to use any of the less than equals operators at all anymore. Yeah. All they do is unpack the thing that's inside one of those settings, and you can just say plus plus equals and say setting dot value instead. It's the same thing. Once you know that trick, a ton of your stuff gets easier. That's the one helpful nugget, I guess.
Okay, so my organizer is saying is basically, you know, we're kind of hitting our time limit today. So what we're gonna do? Let's do one more question from the audience, if there is one. Then I'll ask each of the panelists to basically wish, you know, what should happen. What, like, as the community, we should do next year. And so next year, when we get together for Scala by the Bay 2016, we'll check if that happened or not. Like, what is the most important thing in the next year to assure the future and progress of Scala, right? Like, what should each of us do? What should kind of the PFL do, right? So basically, make kind of a wish slash, you know, resolution. And after that, we'll, you know, go in order and basically assign, you know, prizes for the best questions. So if you have any more questions?
Can I do one more?
Yeah.
So my brother-in-law, who has a degree in political science, but knows that there are people out there going to these crash courses in JavaScript and things like that, has asked me for my opinion. And I'm wondering if anyone has had any success stories with a certain book. I know the Coursera course is very popular. Or is there no hope, and should I say go back to school for a CS degree and then come back and we'll talk?
Atomic Scala.
Yeah, is the question that someone who isn't a trained computer scientist or... I see a lot of people doing that, and I've seen great programmers who had no CS background, like philosophy background, and they're just, so I think somehow this field, you can actually
I know a certain genetic scientist who was fixing bugs in Scala Z stream and proving all sorts of stuff about that, and he was a genetic scientist, so no formal computer software training. Of course, he was a smart guy, too.
I think they pick it up somehow. But,
so part of my question was, do you have any success stories in terms of, do you know what approach they took to learn the language? I'd like to recommend Scala, but I honestly don't know where to start.
I would say for somebody that's completely new to computers or never done anything computer science related, that having something that has visual feedback immediately. So I would go back to, keep plugging this, you know, Scala.js. You can learn Scala, you can immediately see the feedback in the browser. That really drives home, you know, what is it that this person is actually doing. So I would recommend that approach.
Mm. Well, you could also, I have to give a nod to my former passion. Python is a very good beginner's language, and you can get them hooked on Python, then get them hooked on Spark, and then get them to make the Python Scala transition through Spark.
Who can tell all this here? No. No Python. Okay, one more question for the audience.
Hi, my name is Bill Goldsworthy. So, just be quick. When I started learning software is when I changed into computer science, right? That was my first course, and the program chose Java. I was curious. All these years later, I read the letter by Edgar Dijkstra at University of Texas saying why functional was so important, and it got me thinking maybe I should learn it. Has there been an increased adoption or readoption of functional programming, this sort of recent upsurge? And my second follow-up question was, at what age is it appropriate to start teaching functional programming? Because I've got kids who were interested, and if anyone had any feedback on that.
So yeah, I think indeed there is an increased adoption of functional programming, and it's when you have new technology adoption, you always need sort of to have the initial spark that sort of brings it over the hump. And I think for functional programming, that was like parallelism and also distribution in data centers, because then you, in particular the distribution thing, then you have to deal with events and then you want to wrap them in futures, but then you want to be able to compose your futures and boom, you have a monad, right? So I think that was very, very important. Nowadays, I think a lot of people are drifting to it because they have realized that, well, it's actually safer. It makes you happier. You have fewer stupid bugs, you can actually be more productive and more happy at the same time. So these things are then sort of secondary effects, because you can't sell people initially on you're going to be happier doing that, because they won't believe you. You will need sort of a hard technical reason, and that reason has happened, and now we're sort of in the second stage that I think it's almost generally accepted already that functional programming is a very nice and good methodology, and we should be doing more of it. As to teaching, yes, I absolutely think we should think hard about starting to teach with functional languages. At my university, we're currently thinking about how that could happen. There are other examples, like there's Trinity College. Michael Lewis has a very successful course in Scala. There's Kai Horstmann here at San Jose State who does the same. What these people usually do is you just sit people in front of a REPL and let them work with lists or even arrays. It doesn't matter. You just don't need to stress the mutable nature of arrays, and just let them experiment with these things. And one interesting thing I noted is that people usually say Python is actually a good first language because it doesn't have the types. So what I heard from Michael Lewis is to say, well, if you start that way with the REPL, then types are not an issue because you don't write them. The REPL will give you back the types. So types actually help. And I think that's a great way to get started with it. And so nowadays, I would actually recommend, start with REPLs or worksheets and plunge headfirst into functional programming.
So there's this great website called Lightbots, and it teaches recursion to five-year-olds. So I think there's no limit to, you know, how young we can start with functional programming. I believe it's called Lightbots, like as in robots. Okay. You have this little robot, you're trying to move around the screen and you have to light it up. So yeah, after a couple levels, recursion.
Yeah, I mean, I sort of agree. I mean, I think that, you know, like I've heard of kids, you know, writing Minecraft plugins, for example, right? Learning sort of Java, or I mean, if you can do it in Scala. I've met people who write Minecraft plugins in Scala. So I mean, in some sense, you know, I think if you want to talk about kids learning functional programming, that Julie's right, where you just need an interesting thing that's going to behave a certain way and that they're interested in doing, and people will figure it out. You know, people are resourceful. As far as anecdotal evidence, I mean, a friend of mine whose father was a linguistics professor, I think actually was taught Lisp when he was like 12 or something like that. So I mean, you definitely can learn this stuff when you're a kid. It's definitely possible. I mean, on the other hand, there's nothing wrong with learning it in college. You know, like
I was 11, right? Were you 11 when you started? Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. We've got plenty of existence proofs about this. So, you know, but even if you're, you know, a college graduate, you can still. I mean, I've known people who were great programmers who didn't start till they were in their mid 20s. So, you know, I don't think I don't think you're going to like miss the bus or you know be too early for the bus. You know, either way.
Yeah, you're not going to blow anything up. Not unless it's connected to a nuclear power station. Don't let them play with your nuclear power station console,
right.
And you're good
to go.
REPL. Yeah.
One other tool, the first thing we started out when my niece, we were showing her how to program, was called processing. There's a Python and a Java interface. That we did the Java one. That was like you just run it and it pops up and you can already program in it. So you didn't have to do any setup. It was really simple. And you write some code and you push the button and it drew graphs. And that they really responded to that. So I think processing was a kind of a weird name, but that's what it's called.
All right. So I think the last round will be one thing we should do for the betterment of Scala next year, and we'll check in next year. That's sort of the
Okay, so my fondest hope is that by this time next year, the contributor story is well known to everybody. People are talking and thinking in terms of sips and slips and so on, and this process is sort of sustaining itself rather than as it is at the moment, which is somewhat like I feel like I'm sort of pushing the car and jumping in and driving a bit and then getting out and running behind and pushing the car a bit again. So hopefully we can get it to kind of a sustained run.
Yeah, I mean, I guess the thing that I would sort of say is I think my vision would be if, you know, if all Scala projects came with sort of long-form narrative tutorials and documentation with type-checked, runnable code examples. I mean, I think that would be huge, especially since which imports you have in scope often is way more significant in Scala than, say, other languages. I think it's a huge thing. I think everyone should be looking into it, and I think if we are consistent about it and we do it well as a community, it will really help newcomers be able to make progress with these interesting libraries and kind of learn how it all works. So that would be the thing I would say.
Echoing Dick, I would hope that using the SIP and SLIP process, by next year the community has a much better idea where we want to take the standard library and what are the next steps.
So how many of you guys would call yourself new to Scala or beginners, maybe only done it a couple months? Okay, so my hope is that all of you come back. And so if you have feedback, I'm sure everybody would love to hear from you guys how this went and what would get you coming back next year.
So it was hard for me to think of something, so just in my own, I thought of, I would like to get the third edition of the book out. Not a year from now, but sooner than that. So that's one thing. But the one thing I was actually thinking about, going back to the simplicity thing, I've had, you know, I ported Scala test to Scala.js, and that was a huge thing, and it forces a bunch of new features, and it's really hard to figure out how to do that without exploding the size, and it's already ridiculously huge. I mean, it's a test frame, it's got all this stuff in it, and so I think, you know, what happens over time is, you know, is, well, things can just get so out of hand that people can't do the simple things anymore. The Atlassian folks, you know, they buy beer for a Java Posse. They're great folks. But I tell you, Jira, I can't figure out how, I mean, it's got so many features now. So I think, you know, what I think for me personally, what I want to try to focus on, and what I really admire about what Martin said about Dottie, was that he's going to try to simplify the language. He's taking things out, not cramming more stuff in. And I think in Scala test, I'm cramming more stuff in, but I got to try to do it in a way that doesn't turn into Jira. And so that's what I'm trying to do.
All right, I think that was a great journey. It was a great, you know, panel, and I really, you know, thank each of you guys for thoughtful answers. So let's, you know, go maybe from Bill to Dick and pick the, you know, five winners or, you know, askers of the best questions, which were kind of most memorable. Doesn't mean, you know, other questions worse, but whatever kind of most call your attention, you will assign this kind of Typesafe prize to the author of the question.
Oh, it's a different person than the one I answered? Maybe?
It might
can
be.
Well, I think Bill Bourne. I'm going to give it to him because his name's Bill.
If you are in the audience, please come up. If you are in the audience, please come up. We'll give you the bag. If not, you know, we'll find the authors and we'll kind of unite them.
Which
with
one
that
did you choose, Bill?
Bill Bourne, the one okay. I answered. That's why
I'm looking. Yeah. I'm looking for the one. That...
Is Bill Bourne here?
Oh, yeah.
All right. Hey. So this is the industrial grade Typesafe backpack, which basically makes you a perfect Scala programmer.
Thank you. Wow.
That's, we should make more of those.
Yeah, that's one heck of a prize.
Julie.
So is Roberto Burgos here?
Roberto Burgos.
Roberto? Okay, we'll get them back to Roberto.
My vote goes to Brad Rubin.
Brad Rubin. Is Brad here? He was here earlier. Okay, so Brad certainly will be here for the Big Data Scala, so we'll get that back to him.
Katrine or Katrina?
Katrine.
Is she here? Oh, excellent.
Yeah,
yeah, great question.
And I'm going to pick out Edward G. Prentice because I wanted to know about Dottie as well, so I'm glad somebody asked.
Edward? So that concludes our third Scala by the Bay. Hope you guys enjoyed it. If you come back on Monday, it will be a whole new cycle of Big Data Scala. If you don't, we'll miss you dearly, and we hope you come back next year. Please submit a talk. We'll publish the CFP earlier, probably a come January. So please think of a talk already. Start cranking this project, and we hope that you will speak here next year, and we'll carefully note all the resolutions we made here, and we'll check them at the next year panel. So thank you very much. See you next year.